thank you all for coming out tonight. We're going to be discussing the history of Christmas carols, which is very exciting and very seasonally appropriate. And hopefully it will get you all in the mood for the holiday festivities. I am currently working as a branch head at the Island Public Library, which is one of our small locations in Woodbridge Township. And I just want to remind you that we have lots of other programs going on. In January, we're going to have a variety of programs for adults and children and teenagers. So you should always check us out on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or woodbridgelibrary.org. And tonight, like I said, please feel free to ask questions. You can use the chat box at the bottom. We'll try to keep an eye on that. Or you can unmute yourself, ask a question or a comment, and then when you're finished, just mute yourself back up. It just helps the flow of things and the sound quality if we have mostly everybody muted. And you can also message me if you want to privately. I'm Librarian April. And I'm very happy to welcome back Hilary May. She's done a couple of other wonderful programs for us. And she is from the Museum of Early Trades and Crafts, which is located in great, lovely Madison, New Jersey. And they're also at metc.org. So if you can't go there physically right now, depending on the circumstances, check them out on the web as well. So please welcome me and welcoming Hilary May. Take it, Hilary.
Thank you so much, April. Really excited to be back and to see so many people here. And you know, we'll hopefully get a little bit into the holiday spirit here, and snow coming soon will help with that also. I'm just gonna start by talking just briefly about the museum that I'm from, in case people may not be familiar with it. So I'm gonna go ahead and show you some pictures here so that you can see. So this is our beautiful museum building, as April said, right in Madison. So although it looks very much like a church, it has never been a church. It actually was originally built in 1899 as Madison's first public library. So built to look like a church, but with the intent, of course, of being a library. This is what it would have looked like inside as a library. You can just see the bookshelves at the very back of the picture. The sort of balcony would have been up and down. And then the front area is the reading room where you read your books. And in the 1960s, this building became too small for the library for the growing town of Madison. The library moved to its current location. And we had a couple in town, Edgar and Agnes Land, who had been collecting just thousands of objects of everyday life from 18th and 19th century New Jersey. They asked the town of Madison if they could open a museum in this now vacant building, excuse me. The town said yes, and the Museum of Early Trades and Crafts was born in 1969. So this picture here gives you a little bit better idea, obviously a more recent picture, but all of the architecture and decorations are original to the library. Stained glass windows, vaulted arch ceilings, hand-stenciled walls, all of that. So you would have been able to have that as your library, or if you do come visit us today, we do now have our exhibits in this beautiful space there. I'll just give a pause for a moment in case anyone has any questions on the museum or the building before we turn to our Christmas carols, our main focus of our program here. And as I go along, please do feel free to throw questions or comments into the chat. I'll keep an eye on that. If you also want to unmute yourself and ask something, that's totally fine with me. I will be playing carols as we go along, and I'll talk more about that kind of when we get to that. We're going to start. What kind of exhibits do we have? Well, thank you, Pamela. Great question. So we sort of, generally speaking, we tell the stories of ordinary people from 18th and 19th century New Jersey. So our sort of permanent exhibits include some various trade sort of almost vignettes, for example, blacksmith, cabinet maker, cooper, things like that, sort of all their tools and everything, as well as an exhibit called Working the Land, which highlights the agricultural history of New Jersey, what would have been life for almost everybody in this part of the, you know, particularly in New Jersey, but really much of the world at that time. And then we also have changing exhibits, So, for example, the one you just saw the picture in here of, this shows an exhibit called Narrative Threads that we had a couple years ago, highlighting some of our textiles and the textile arts of New Jersey. And then our current special exhibit is a little bit of a topical one called Cholera to COVID-19, looking at diseases and pandemics throughout history of New Jersey. So just like a wide range of historical topics, really focusing on telling, you know, bringing to light as many different stories of New Jerseyans as we can, but sort of using objects to tell those stories. Thanks, Pamela. Great question. So we're going to start by looking at the broader sort of general history of carols, how they came to be, how we came to have, you know, this tradition of singing carols at this time of year. And then we'll look specifically at a number of different carols and their particular origin, also continuing to look at some trends with them, but we'll sort of start broad and then go into the specific carols. So the origin of Christmas carols goes back to pagan traditions. So long before Christianity, you had pagans who sang carols at the winter solstice, and in fact at other seasons of the year as well. The idea of this, the singing these songs to celebrate the season, or maybe ask for certain things to occur, is a very, very, very old one. And even today, you can see that the definition of carol is an old round dance or a song of joy or mirth. So, you know, you can definitely see that in many of our popular carols today, that very dance-like feel. They are often very joyful. So that definition certainly persists with our carols, but carols long predate the way that we most commonly use them today. So in terms of looking at the development of carols, so in a way you have some of this occur as Christianity starts to grow, and there's a lot of usage of pagan traditions to sort of bring people along to this new religion, you know, turning things that were part of that pagan practice into part of early Christianity. And carols still remain more on the folk side of things. But an important shift to note comes in this sort of around 1223. You have what may have been the first nativity scene that were now being done in the vernacular and related to carols being sung in the vernacular. And why this is so significant? This time, church services were said in Latin. Your average person did not speak Latin, and so had no idea what was actually going on in church. Imagine going to church week after week after week and having no clue, really, what was being talked about. So the creation of these nativity scenes and plays in the vernacular, or, you know, in English, German, French, etc., was hugely impactful in terms of letting the ordinary person understand these stories that they were hearing about in church every week, but really were not understanding. This is sort of a significant development in here, and sort of brings carols along with it. So we don't have a lot of these early carols, unfortunately. Most of them haven't survived. You do start to get more coming out in the 14th, 15th century. Some of the ones that we're going to look at more specifically do have some origins going back that far. But we're still talking about songs that are very, very much sung at home. They are not part of the church service. They are, even if they are touching on religious themes, which they may or may not, but they are things sung outside the church, not within church. You also have the tradition of wassailing or caroling, something all right, there we go. I got muted there. Okay. So yeah, so our tradition of caroling or wassailing, something we still all love to do today, or at least I certainly greatly enjoy caroling, and many people still do today. But this is also a very old pagan tradition that really the church was not happy about, because it did have those pagan origins, even as they were trying to sort of co-opt a few of these traditions. They really wanted to break away from those pagan traditions in a lot of other ways. So wassailing becomes, again, a sort of folk thing, but a way of spreading these carols further, you know, spreading that joy or mirth also, that, you know, right there in that definition of carols. Oops. All right.
Wassail all over the town, the coast, it is white and our hair, it is brown, our body, it is made of a white maple tree, with a wassail home we'll bring to thee.
So that's just a little snippet of a song that's called Wassail, literally a song about wassailing, just to give us a small taste of sort of an earlier song, literally about this tradition of caroling. There's some other early carol examples here. So we're going to hear two of them here. The first one, Personant Hodie, is in Latin. You can very much imagine it being sung in church with the organ and all of that. The other, the Boar's Head Carol, is quite different. It's really relating to that idea of having a boar's head for your big feast about this time. So you can sort of picture, you know, a lord's manor, a lord's medieval manor with servants bringing in the boar's head for the group to eat, for the party to eat. So we'll do first Personant Hodie and then Boar's Head Carol here. So very, you can hear the organ, you can very much see how that's something that's developing within the church, sort of what we would expect as perhaps part of a church service, contrasting with
the boar's head in hand bear I, bedecked with bays and rosemary. And I pray you, my masters, be merry, for testis in convivio.
So again, you can sort of see that very majestic sense to it, the very, you know, feeling of servants marching in with that impressive platter. So not about religion, not about Christmas per se, very much a carol of the season and the time of year more than anything else. And we'll kind of see developing with even later carols kind of two strands, ones that are very much, you know, Christmas carols telling the story of Christmas, and carols that are more about the season and the time of year and things like that. So kind of two strands that we'll be looking at. So another big sort of milestone in our development here is the Reformation. So starting in 1517, Luther's breaking away, starts a, you know, series of other Protestant religions coming into being. And you have, again, sort of multiple strands of what happens here. So within Germany, which has very strong Lutheranism and all of that, songs had already existed very strongly in Germany, and that continued. It was accepted and sort of brought into that Lutheran tradition. In contrast, Puritans, who were dominant in England for a time, and of course, you know, have influence in the new colonies that become the United States, did not use carols in that. They certainly rejected music as part of the tradition. So you don't have the same development of carols within those areas, and certainly not within the church tradition. Anything that's developing would have been still on that popular level a little bit, maybe not fully secret per se, but certainly not something that's being done sanctioned by the church authorities. And so you really then get what we would think of as modern carol singing in Victorian England, coming out of Prince Albert's German customs, which coming again, we said that those German carols were developing very strongly with that Lutheran traditions. And then the English ones that are the more popular carols mixing together, there's now acceptance of it in a broader part of English society. And it really sort of becomes what we think of today. And also the play A Christmas Carol became very popular. You can hardly think of a Christmas carol without carols being sung. And that was true in the 19th century as well. So it very much would have become something that people saw more, that they wouldn't not necessarily have seen carols before. And this really sort of grew the popularity and use of Christmas carols. And many of our traditions did come out in this period, including Christmas trees and gift giving and things. So much of what we think of as sort of standard Christmas traditions are only about 200 years old. And singing carols in churches, really only late 19th century, you know, 150 years that it's been that that's been a common regular part of church services. Turn now to our specific carols, going through them. Couple notes here. For each carol, I will play it first, and the lyrics will be up on the screen. You are welcome to sing along. If you want to unmute and sing, you are more than welcome to. Just be aware that with Zoom, there can be some slight delay, but you are welcome to unmute and sing or sing anonymously in the comfort of your own home. But do enjoy that. I'll play at least one verse of each carol to kind of give us a feel for that. And then we'll talk about its history and things like that. And certainly do feel free to continue putting in any questions or anything as we go along. We'll look at these sort of roughly chronologically, roughly in large part because often we don't know the exact origin of these carols. Also, it's not uncommon for the lyrics and the music to develop and separately and only sort of come together at a later point. You might have a very, very old song that didn't quite, you know, get matched with those words until later and things like that. So only very, very roughly chronological. Sticking with some of the sort of more traditional carols within the sort of Western Europe and United States tradition, but bringing into some of the more modern ones and things like that. Of course, we could do many, many, many more carols if you're doing an around the world tour, but having to focus in somewhere here for the sake of finishing sometime tonight. All right, we're going to start with the Holly and the Ivy, a very traditional sort of English carol and not always the most friendly to sing, but very beautiful. Such a very beautiful, peaceful song, you know, really, really nice to listen to. This one sort of came together a little bit later, but definitely has some older strands to it. A little bit unusual in terms of what it's referencing. It's talking a lot about evergreens, things like the holly and the ivy, which of course would not have been present at sort of the original Christmas story, you know, in Bethlehem. They tend to become very symbolic. And just a few of the symbolism that's sort of built into this. Holly symbolizes Jesus's crown. Ivy, the faithfulness and eternal life. You have the white of the flower for Christ's purity, the red of the berry for Christ's blood, the prickly leaves for the crown of thorns. So there's this very strongly symbolic nature to everything mentioned in this song, less than a literal discussing of these plants being present at the original Christmas story. And Karen, I think you're probably right. It may be the Boar's Head one. I'm not 100% sure, but I would not be surprised if that's still the one that they sing. Certainly, Oxford and Cambridge definitely still do sing many of these traditional carols. You may be familiar with the 9 lessons and carols that they do every year at, I think, Cambridge, which definitely, I can't remember if Boar's Head Carol is part of that one, but certainly Holly and the Ivy is and some of these others. So it very, very well could be, Karen. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. Next, I saw 3 ships.
I saw 3 ships come sailing by on Christmas Day, on Christmas Day. I saw 3 ships come sailing by on Christmas Day in the morning.
And what was in the ships of 3 on Christmas Day, on Christmas Day?
Christmas Day in the morning. A Savior Christ and Jesus on Christmas Day, on Christmas Day. A Savior
Oh, Irina, I'm so glad you love it. Yeah, it's such an upbeat, dance-like one. You almost can't help but move when you hear it, right? It definitely captures that dance-like feeling we talked about. So fun. And definitely that very sort of repetitive nature that makes it very nice and fun to sing. So another one probably originating in Victorian England, although it seems to have, even earlier, some versions of the song are appearing. Yeah, I'm so glad you like it too, Pat. Yeah, it is not one of the most common. So it's sort of fun to get in some of these carols that are not as well played or covered, I suppose you could say. This is another one, kind of like the Holly and the Ivy, where the words are clearly not meant to be taken literally. You, of course, cannot have a ship sailing actually into Bethlehem. There is no body of water near Bethlehem. So it's another metaphoric one. It could simply be the three ships that did take the relics of the Magi in the 12th century. Three, of course, is an important number within Christianity for many, many things. Could just be the three kings. Also could be Wenceslas, who we'll get to in just a moment, his coat of arms included three ships. So it could also be a reference to that. So lots of possibilities of where that song comes from, but so fun, so dance-like. I'm so glad some of you enjoy hearing this less commonly played song. So have to then go to Good King Wenceslas, since we just brought him up.
Good King Wenceslas looked out on the feast of Stephen, when the snow lay round about, deep and crisp and even. Brightly shone the moon as night, though the frost was cruel, when a woman came in sight, having winter view. Stand by me, if thou knowst his tearing. Yonder peasant, who is he? There and what his dwelling?
Sahil is a goodly hence, underneath the mountain, right against the forest fence, by St. Agnes Fountain.
And the story goes on from there. Somewhat unusually, this one is very narrative. It doesn't have sort of verse, chorus, like so many do. There's none of that repetition. It's just very much telling a story. And this one, the words were written in the 19th century, but using a much older tune. It's based on a real person, although he was a duke, not a king, and his name was Vaclav the Good, not Wenceslas. But he was this apparently relatively good ruler who did give things to the poor, sort of as immortalized in this song. Which is about the season, right? The sort of a season to be kind to other people and to take care of those less fortunate. And it's this wonderful song that sort of encapsulates that idea. Unfortunately, the actual inspiration for this song did not have such a good end. His brother, not such a good guy, decided he wanted to be the Duke instead and did unfortunately kill his brother, making him a martyr and a saint. So a sad ending, but he has a really nice sort of immortalization through this song. Ding dong, merrily on high.
Ding dong, merrily on high, and the bells are ringing. Ding dong, verily the sky is ringing with angels singing. Oh, 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 oh,
Yes, yes. So I'm so glad you enjoy it, Karen. And yeah, it is very similar to Angels We Have Heard on High, that same sort of repeated Gloria, another fun one to sort of sing in choir and things like that. And so dance-like, which makes sense because it was originally a dance tune that was set to these words. But, you know, the music goes back further as a dance song and then was, you know, given the words that we know of it today. So much later that you do get the specific words that we think of. And it's evoking something that, even by 1924, would not have been particularly common, would have been a little bit more anachronistic. But this idea of bells and the role they would play in people's lives, quite apart from just Christmas time, you know, people did not have watches or anything like that to sort of keep their time. You know, the bells of the church bell in your town would have been the way to tell you anything of time, when to go to church, anything good, anything bad, all those sorts of communications would have been done via those church bells. So it's also touching on what would have been a very, very familiar thing for people at an earlier time, and maybe sort of a little bit of nostalgia perhaps for that in the early 20th century as that's starting to change. Changing tempo here a little bit to a much quieter one.
The first Noel the angel did say was to certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep. On a cold winter night that was so deep. Noel, 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 born is the King of Israel. They look it up and saw a star shining in the east beyond them far, and to the earth it gave great light, and so it continued both day.
Continues on. Margaret, I don't know if you were the first Noel or Ding Dong Maryland High is your favorite, but I'm glad we've hit on your favorite either way. So this one probably goes back, you know, 18th century, but coming together to be published later. Interestingly enough, not originally written N-O-E-L, that French spelling, but N-O-W-E-L-L, the old English spelling, and then changed to that French spelling, perhaps to make it sound a little more perhaps exotic, something like that, but it was an old English spelling originally. And of course, you know, that meaning Christmas in French there. Very majestic song. You can hear those trumpets playing and all of that. This is one of my favorite origins, or at least I think one of the most interesting origins, perhaps. Another one where lyrics and music come totally separate. So the lyrics are written by Charles Wesley, who is one of the founders of Methodism, one of those many Protestant religions that are coming into being at this time. But he wrote it to be, "Hark how all the welkin rings." Welkin meaning, you know, a word for sky or heavens. It was changed by his co-founder of Methodism, George Whitefield, about 20 years later to the "Hark the Herald Angels Sing" that we know, which of course trips off the tongue a little bit better. Hark how all the welkin rings just doesn't quite work as well. But Wesley was not happy about this. He didn't think that this is what the Bible was intending to say, so he was not happy about this change. Totally separately, the music is composed by Felix Mendelssohn. As a commemoration of the 400th anniversary of the Gutenberg Press, and after this anniversary had passed, he said that this music could be used for anything as long as it wasn't religious. After his death, his music and lyrics are combined, so this highly popular, highly iconic carol probably would not meet with the approval of either the lyricist or the composer, but we all love and enjoy it nonetheless.
Oh, Christmas tree, that we must fair and lovely. Oh, Christmas tree, that we must fair and lovely. The sight of thee at Christmas times with its hope and gladness far and wide.
Very peaceful one, O Tannenbaum, O Christmas Tree, of course, originally in German. And in fact, was originally just a German folk song that had nothing to do with Christmas. It was essentially an ode to the fir tree, praising the constants of the fir tree, its never changing nature, and so on. Nothing at all to do with Christmas or anything like that. So in 1824, when Ernst Anschutz writes the modern German lyrics, he bases it on those older folk lyrics, but adds some of his own to the verses that are more specifically referencing Christmas do come from his additions there and his tweaks. And then when it gets translated into English, it becomes "O Christmas Tree" instead of "O Fir Tree," and its association with Christmas has become more solidified. And that's also the time period when it becomes more common to have Christmas trees in your home as part of decorating for Christmas. So all of that sort of combines to make this a Christmas carol, quite different from its original or origination, I guess you could say, but how it originated. So I will just say this is one of my favorites, in part because musically it's a little more interesting because it's one of a very few Christmas carols that is in a minor key, not a major key, if you are musically inclined.
God rest you merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay, for Jesus Christ our Savior was born upon this day to save us all from Satan.
Very Victorian carol, although the lyrics probably go back even further. But you can definitely picture those Victorians singing it. It's often sung as part of a Christmas carol, and you can definitely see it sort of part of that genre. So a couple of fun things about the title here in terms of sort of fun with the English language. So it is often written and sung as "God rest you merry, comma, gentlemen." I apologize. It's usually written as "God rest you, comma, merry gentlemen," meaning as it's extorting the merry gentlemen to rest. In fact, the original way that it's written is the comma you can see in yellow there, that it's "God rest you, merry, comma, gentlemen," rest meaning keep in this case. So it's instead exhorting the gentlemen to keep themselves merry. A little bit of fun with the English language and the movement of a comma to give a different meaning to the word, whether the gentlemen are being asked to keep merry or whether the merry gentlemen are being asked to rest. Also the ye that often is sung with, God rest ye merry gentlemen, is a 19th century addition, not from those original 15th century lyrics. Old timey and old fashioned and all of that, but not the actual original lyrics. Right. So definitely a song frequently sung now in church services, specifically Catholic church services often sing this, of course, originally in Latin, Adeste Fidelis, translated to O Come All Ye Faithful. And this one sort of coming out in its current version, 19th century, like so many of these. Now, there is some speculation that this has a sort of interesting origination. Hard to prove this one way or the other, but according to this one historian, not to go too far down the rabbit hole of English history, but you have Bonnie Prince Charlie, who was the descendant of the deposed King James II, who was Catholic, as was Bonnie Prince Charlie. And there were those in England who felt that Bonnie Prince Charlie should be the King of England. They were Catholics and they were called Jacobites, and they opposed the current king. And so as this theory goes, this song was essentially a code between these believers. So according to this, the Fidelis is a faithful Catholic Jacobite. Bethlehem is a word that was often used by them for England. And the king that we are being asked to adore is not Jesus, but Bonnie Prince Charlie. So a little bit of a different possible interpretation. Hard to prove one way or the other, but that is a theory about the origination of this particular carol. One of many people's favorites now. Certainly see why it's one of the most recorded songs in the world, very, very popular, beloved by many people. Of course, originally written in German in 1816 by an Austrian prince, in fact. Oh, yes, to sing this is a lullaby. Yeah, Pamela, right. This one has such a feel of a lullaby, doesn't it? It's so calming, so sweet, absolutely. My mom sang it to me as well as a lullaby. And according to legend, the way this was sort of came into being as it's known, so the lyrics have been written earlier, but this priest, Joseph Moore, had the organ break in his church. And so he asked his friend to compose guitar music to support it because they had no organ. And whether or not that's completely true, it certainly is that very simple song, just very simple chords. It doesn't need the full organ to really do it justice like others of these. Just that simple melody, simple chords, and so on. you know, translated into English a little bit later. And it has a very sort of nice claim to fame of sorts that during the Christmas truce of World War I, December 1914, when these soldiers who were in fighting this terrible, terrible war took a break for a night, this song was something that helped bring them together. You, of course, had many English, American, and German soldiers who all knew this song, different words, same beautiful tune, sort of using this as some common ground amidst so much conflict. Changing our tempo quite a bit here to Jingle Bell.
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Oh, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Dashing through the snow in a one-horse open sleigh. Over the fields we go, laughing all the way. Bells on bobtails ring, making spirits bright. What fun it is to ride and sing a sleighing song tonight. Oh, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Oh, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh.
And we go on from there. Such a fun, upbeat one. Definitely, you know, popular, particularly by children, but adults as well. Just so fun to sing, to listen to. Is a 19th century carol, unusual among the ones we've talked about and being composed by an American. And in fact, it was originally a Thanksgiving carol called the One Horse Open Sleigh. So not written for Christmas, doesn't of course have anything referencing Christmas. Really an ode to that the idea of being out in the snow in your one horse open sleigh, something not so common to us today, but at that time this would have been a very familiar thing to reference, the idea of being pulled in your sleigh across the snow. My picture there has two horses, but I imagine one horse, that's sort of the idea that it's evoking. And it, you know, eventually does become associated as a Christmas carol, but that was not its origination. So James Pierpont, there's two different cities who try to claim that he composed it there, both Medford, Mass and Savannah, Georgia, like to take credit, but he was in neither of those places in 1857. When he was in fact in California attempting to cash in on the gold rush. He was unsuccessful at getting rich with the gold rush, but did manage to compose this wonderful song that, you know, is so popular to sing as now today. What the halls? Thank you, Harriet, for that correction. I apologize. English and German soldiers in 1914. Yes, you would not have had any significant numbers of American soldiers. Thank you, Harriet, for that. So Deck the Halls was originally a popular Welsh song. And the words were originally a little bit different. They were written by the Scottish musician, Thomas Oliphant. And they included things like, fill the mead cup, drain the barrel. And it was very much written as a New Year's or Yuletide song. And in a lot of ways, it was kind of just a New Year's drinking song, is kind of how it was originally written and a lot of those words. It gets sort of mediated a little bit. And by 1877, we have our Don We Now Our Gay Apparel. And it's a little bit more, benign and universally applicable. And some of those other more explicit, references to drinking also made it at that time. So yes, drain the barrel indeed. Yes, it was a little bit of a different interpretation of this song and its original versing, but still definitely something that's celebrating the season and the time of year and the joy of the season, not a Christmas carol specifically as such. bringing it down a little bit again here. The origination of the song in just a moment, but first to note that there is a second music that goes with this. The one we just heard is the original and is the tune used in the United States. What we're going to hear in a moment is what's used in the United Kingdom instead. So I won't play the whole thing there, but you get the idea. Different tune, same words, and so on. This is another one written by an American rector, in this case, from Philadelphia. He did go on a pilgrimage from Jerusalem to Bethlehem. And his church organist just set it to music. That first music we heard was that original music. And then in England, they used an old folk tune instead. So using the same words, but setting it to their own music instead. And Pat, I will have to check my notes and I can sort of get back to you. I don't off the top of my head, I apologize, have the historian who has that particular reference, but I can send that along via the library to pass along if you're interested. So it's probably not the most well known, but it's an interesting one to include for a couple of reasons, but it is certainly a very beautiful tune. I'll just play a little bit of it. Most common ones, but a very, very beautiful, peaceful song. And one thing that makes it a little bit unusual is that it was written the words by a woman. These other ones that we've looked at, and at least that are known, are all men. This is an English poet, Christina Rossetti, relatively well-known English poet. Wasn't written to be a song, and you can sort of see that in the way it's very much sort of a narrative, long poem, not something that has the form that lyrics written for music might have. She did just write it as sort of a competition for a Christmas-themed poem, published 1872, and then about 30 years later does get set to music, after her death by Gustav Holst's, his music, and becoming this sort of beautiful carol that is more common in England than it would be here today, but is a nice one to look at nonetheless.
Hark how the bells, sweet silver bells, all seem to say, throw cares away, Christmas is here, bringing good cheer, to young and old, ding and the bull, ding dong ding dong, that is the song, ding triple ring, all caroling, one seems to hear words of good cheer from everywhere, filling the air, oh, how they bow, raising the sound, going in the tale, telling the tale, ringing their ear, while people sing songs of good cheer.
Goes on and sort of has that repetitious nature here. So this is one that was written with totally different lyrics, but was written the music for a 1916 Ukrainian Christmas choir concert. And those original lyrics, although they were written for a choir concert, were not written about Christmas. They were much more celebrating the Ukrainian New Year. So it was sort of a New Year's holiday, sort of a seasonal song, not a Christmas song. And then when it gets translated into English, this man, Peter J. Wilhowski, takes the tune, but writes completely different lyrics. So the lyrics that we know of today have no relation to the original Ukraine. It's not a translation as a complete new song in terms of lyrics written to the same music. But definitely you can tell it's one written for choral voices. It works so nicely with that four-part a cappella choir, which is what it was written for. And you can really hear those bells ringing, that chiming and all of that. Very fun feel to it, and sort of still dance-like as well, like a lot of these others.
Sleigh bells ring, are you listening? In the lane, snow is glistening. A beautiful sight, we're happy tonight, walking in the winter wonderland. Gone away is the bluebird, here to stay is a new bird. He sings a love song as we go along, walking in the winter wonderland. In the meadow we can build a snowman, then pretend that he is Parson Brown. He'll say, are you married? We'll say, no, man, but you can do the job when you're in town. Later on, we'll conspire as we dream by the fire to face unafraid the plans that we made walking in the winter wonderland.
So another really fun seasonal carol, very much commemorating the time of year and the snow and all of that. This one, we do know who wrote both lyrics and music. This man, Richard B. Smith, wrote the lyrics. Quite sadly, when he wrote them, he was actually in the hospital being treated for tuberculosis, but he was looking out over the snow and where the hospital was in Pennsylvania and was inspired to write this wonderful little song that was later set to music. Now, unfortunately, he did pass away not too long after and wasn't able to see the impact and popularity of this carol as it developed over time. But it is sort of interesting and sort of poignant to think about him writing this wonderful, upbeat, happy song while in such a sort of dire situation. Definitely a very fun one to sing and to listen to as well there. Last carol we're going to look at is 12 Days of Christmas, an appropriate way to end. So for this one, I am going to talk about it first and then sort of play some of it because it talking through some of the symbolism within it. And I'll get to some of the other possible origins in a minute, but it is an English tune, but maybe even also having some French origins, maybe coming together. From both countries there. And the music that we have now is added much later. So anything that was around in that earlier period was very different than the carol that we would know of today. Obviously, 12 Days of Christmas, talking about that period from Christmas Day to the Epiphany. And this is another one that has some argument about that it may have been used to teach English Catholics about Catholicism a little earlier than the true Jacobites, but sort of that earlier period when it was not legal to be Catholic in England. And so trying to teach children about Catholicism through this song, not too much evidence that particular theory is true, but there is certainly strong symbolism regardless within the Catholic faith for each of the levels of this song. So sort of run through those to give you a sense of that symbolism, again, whether or not it came out of a time when Catholicism was illegal in England or simply that symbolism on itself, it's still very much present. So, partridge in a pear tree, Jesus dying on the cross, Old and New Testaments of the Bible for the two turtle doves, three French hens. There are many threes. But this includes, you know, the charity and so on. Many threes in Christianity. The four Gospels in the New Testament. Five golden rings are the first five books of the Bible. Also the Torah within the Jewish faith. 6 days of creation. Seven Sabbaths. Eight Beatitudes, which are Jesus' teachings on happiness. Nine fruits of the Holy Spirit. 10 commandments. 11 faithful disciples of Jesus. And 12 points of the Apostles' Creed. Okay. Wait for a moment, we won't go all the way through here. And of course, it keeps going and going, and someone had fun. I can't take credit for this. Someone did a little bit of math to figure out how many gifts this would be in total if it were physical things, which sort of speaks to the fact that although this was intended as a very symbolic song, it certainly has, people have had fun with it in many ways. It certainly gets sort of adapted to many different types of wording and things like that. It's certainly one that lends itself well to adaptation in a lot of ways. But that brings me to the end of the carols. But if anyone does have any other questions that we haven't touched on, I know it's almost 8 o'clock here, but if anyone does want to ask anything else in chat or unmute yourself, please feel free to do so. Anyone have a favorite carol that we didn't talk about?
Hi, Hilary. I'm not sure if you can hear me.
Yep, you're good.
Hi, this is coming around from Massachusetts.
Oh, excellent. And
I wanted to just bring up the wassails. Massachusetts and New England was very resistant about celebrating Christmas in puritanical days. And part of the wassailing was that people would go home to home and beg for food, and the master of the house would have to allow the people in. And if you listen to We Wish You a Merry Christmas, the wassailers demand figgy pudding, and they say, we won't go until we get some. So it was a bit of an extortion going on back then.
Yes, absolutely. Such a great point. Yes. A little bit of maybe the darker side of caroling, for sure. But yeah, absolutely. Thank you for bringing that up. That's great. Thank you.
And thank you for this. It was really wonderful in this bleak time that we're dealing with. It's nice to have this sort of thing that we all can get together.
Oh, well, I'm glad you enjoyed it. And I'm glad you could join us from so far away. It is sort of a positive of having to do things virtually, as it allows people to join from far away. So,
thank you.
You're very welcome, everyone. I'm so glad you all enjoyed it. I want to make sure I'm not missing any questions. You're so welcome. Yes, thank you. Yes, please do, everyone, have a healthy and happy holiday season. You can all, a little bit different than normal, but hopefully still find some joy and peace in the holiday season.
Thank you, everybody, for attending tonight. Thank you, Hilary. This was a wonderful presentation. I can't wait to look up the Boar's Head song. And if you can, please visit the museum online at metc.org and join us for other programs at woodbridgelibrary.org. You'll see a calendar, and all of our events are free and open to all. And we will be posting this on YouTube.
Okay. A little bit, April. You're breaking up a little bit, April. A little bit, April.